Welcome to the Modern Maker Workroom. I'm Matthew Nagy. This second series of videos is going to cover the cut and construction of a man's doublet, and specifically the man's doublet from the Modern Maker Volume 1, Men's Doublets. And it's come about because a lot of people have questions about the techniques, and while photographs are very helpful, we at the Modern Maker are moving toward a video format, so it makes sense to take Volume 1 and put some instructions in video form. Now, my suggestion is to buy the book and use it in conjunction with these videos. I think that they're meant to go together. Now, each one should be able to get you from start to finish on its own, but I think together they'll be an even stronger set of tools. So let's get started. I'm ready to begin the drafting of this doublet pattern, and you'll be able to follow along if you have the Modern Maker Volume 2, the pattern manual, on page 73. That's the draft that I'm using. Just so you know, we always begin with the back of the doublet, then we draft the front, then typically collars and skirts, followed by sleeves at the very end. Now, your order of operations might shift a little bit over time, but really the essential thing is to draft the back first and then the front second. And that rule holds true for every upper body garment. So I have three different tapes here. I've got the 36 inch tape, which is for my length. Now, I am actually just slightly under 6 feet tall, which if you're calculating the length tape, you just use exactly half of your total height. So I'm not quite 6 feet tall. Half of that is like 35 3/8-ish is my actual half height. So I'm just rounding up to 36 because it's easier than rounding down. I think rounding down might shorten things a little bit too much. I have 37 inches for my waist and 44 inches for my chest. Each of these will be used in the appropriate location. So to begin, I'm going to set my waist tape aside because I really only need it for one step in the back of this garment. And I'll begin by drafting the center back. The way the system works, you need to plot two sets of points in a very specific order. So we start by plotting the vertical points along a foundation line, and then off of those points, we then mark a bunch of horizontal points, basically creating a small grid. And what we do once we have all those points is we connect the dots and create the shape of the pattern. Now, my tendency is to partially draw the pattern shape as I go. You can actually just draw all the points and then connect the dots at the end. I prefer to see the pattern take shape as I go. It's my habit, and I think that just comes from years of mathematical drafting, which works a little bit differently than a proportional draft. But either way, let's get started. So I have my diagram here right in front of me so that I make sure that I'm following it. That way, when you're using the book, you can follow it as well. I typically will draft the back with the neckline to the left and the waist to the right. And then when I draft the front, I'll reverse that. And what that means is when the patterns are laying flat next to each other, they're both right side up and I can see all my notations. So let's begin. First thing I'll do is just draw a nice long foundation line. Okay, I'm not paying a whole lot of attention. And now I will place the back. And this is actually the waist mark, and I measure up from the waist. I like to put the waist down low toward the edge of the paper because I need to make sure I have room for my collar up top. My tendency when I've drafted this before is I'll start by making a mark for the neckline and then suddenly I've run out of paper at the top end of the pattern. So I want to avoid that. So I'll mark my waist first down here and then I'll work my way up. So I need MI is the center back length from A to the waistline in the back. So that's done with the length tape. So the notation is L-MI. So I'm putting zero here at my mark and I have M right here and I can just swing the end of the tape measure around and add my I right there. So then this is now A according to the draft. Now there is another mark below MI, but that one's done regulating with the chest tape, and this has everything to do with the thickness of the body. So I'm going to go ahead and make that mark here as well. We have L, MI, and then we have CI. So I've just added one dedo below, but you can see that there's quite a bit of difference between the size of a chest dedo and a length dedo. It's almost an eighth of an inch difference between the two of them. And what that chest dedo is, that just regulates the drop of the side of the waist as it goes down the body. So the next thing I'll do is I'll mark the rest of the points. I don't need the length tape anymore. Really, the length tape for the back is just here so that I can mark the full center back length from base of neck. However, I need it one more time . Here I have the full back length. I have one more measurement that I need to use the length tape for. Once I do that, then I can set the length tape aside. So what I need to do is I need to locate the actual center back neck. So we can use the chest tape along the foundation and let's just mark all of our horizontal points while we're here. So I have LCI, I have II, and then I have SII, which is halfway between S and Q, that I'm going to mark right here. And that's it for those points along there that I need the chest tape for. Now I will set this aside and I'll use the length tape for my remaining measurements. Let me just label these so that you can see them. Typically, I don't label these points just because I've been working with the system for so long and drafting for so long, I don't need the references, but you probably should if you're just a beginner. So from here, I have CI at this point, and I'm going to measure inward from CI one dedo with the length tape. And what that does is it sets the center back neck just a little bit in so that there's an angle. And that helps with the fit, helps with the curvature of the collar, but more than that, it used the length tape because it is less likely to change dramatically than the chest tape. From size to size, the chest tape could change really dramatically. And if I use the chest tape for that on a very large person, it could be extremely deviated inward, which is not as far as it needs to go just for the human body. Typically, it's a relatively consistent increment. So use the length tape in order to keep that less dramatic. So the next thing I need the length tape for is to measure upward for the height of the collar. And that's measured from A, and the length is DI. So DI is halfway between D and O, and that gives us a really tall collar. And one thing that you'll notice is people tend to cheat their collars really small. And I think that's kind of typical of German and English styles in the early 17th century, where they had already switched to different kinds of collars with their shirts, where it didn't need so much support. But what's typical with Spanish clothing is that you need a lot of support. This collar is very heavily interfaced and interlined. So, it gets folded down underneath an actual linen collar of some kind, whether it's a ruff, whether it is a Golia collar, any one of those styles, this collar gets folded down and the extra stiffness helps support whatever is laying on top. So you can see that I just connected the dots. I partially drew it here. I have my center back line that goes to MI, and then I have my collar height that goes to LI. I actually blend to LI, even though it's measured from A, the full collar height is actually closer to 1/8. So if you can actually see here, it's just slightly over 1/8. And that'll become clear as we work more into the front collars as well. The next thing I'm going to do is set aside my length tape. I'm going to pull up my chest tape and I'm going to start marking all the rest of my horizontals. So I'll always begin at A and work my way down, and then for some reason I just tend to like to do the collar last. It's just a habit I've gotten into, and I think it has a lot to do with making decisions about the collar based on what the rest of the garment looks like. I need to measure widths next, so I'm going to draw guidelines from most of my points here. I don't need one at CI because that one's already been used. That's the base of the neck. But from CII, I'm going to extend a line out. And from CSI, I'm going to extend a line out as well. And also from CI down low. Okay? The width of the collar is measured at CD. So that's 1/12 of the chest tape. And the mark is just given, and it says CD right here. But that is actually measured from LI from here. So that's in the initial instructions in chapter 2. So there is CD right there. And if I want to, and I usually do, I just draw a dotted line so that I know that's a back neck line. So from here, I will measure my length straight up as well. And I'll get to finishing up the collar in a little bit. Next width is the shoulder span. So this is CII, and that means that's the shoulder slope. The shoulder itself should be S if you're a guy. And if you're a woman, you're using the chest tape and you'll measure OI. And the reason for that is women's chests are disproportionately larger to their skeletal structure when compared with men's, in that your bust measurement adds tissue to the chest measurement, but your skeletal structure is actually slightly smaller than the same chest measurement on a man. So we'll use a slightly shorter shoulder width for women's doublets. The next thing I do is I'll just draw a straight line to get the shoulder, and I'll look at this, and about a third of the way down, I'm going to deviate in, you know, about a quarter of an inch, 6 millimeters, something like that. Gives a nice smooth shoulder curve, right? The next width I'm going to mark off is the bottom of the back armhole. Now this is actually sort of shoulder blade level. This does not indicate the true bottom of the armhole. I've had a lot of people email me saying, I've measured everything off and the chest is huge, and that's because they're not measuring at the actual chest, which is somewhere down here. They're measuring here, and there's extra ease around the back of the armhole to allow for a small fold of fabric in this area on the back of the body. This width is listed as CQ. Now that, if I were to use CQ, goes all the way to here. And I like this amount of ease. It's a little bit high, honestly. Like if you were to compare it to how a garment fits in the modern world, there's a little bit too much ease across the back. But knowing how tight this garment is and knowing how much movement that people tended to need for work with their hands going in front, this width is actually not bad. You can use IQ if you want. Now, once I have that mark drawn, I'll make a 90 degree angle line coming off of the shoulder, and then I'm going to blend into here. Now I have to turn the paper in order to make this work. Because you really want to draw the line from the inside. So that gives us the back armhole. And I really don't have a measurement for how much I curve this. I keep it as flat as possible because most of the extant garments, this is either a straight line or it's a very shallow curve. Rarely do you see it as a dramatic curve. The next width I'm going to do is the waist width. And for that, I'm going to need to pick up my waist tape, which is here. And the width at the waist is SI. So that's 1/6 plus 1 dedal. So I'm gonna make just a gentle mark at S, and then I'm gonna scoot the tape down so that I have the width here. Now I'm doing this along the line at CI below LMI because that's for the drop of the back waist. And then I'm going to connect gently that line. See that right here? And I'm keeping 90 degrees at my junction with center back. Now this here is the center back line. It's one that's at a slight angle because it goes from LMI to this LI at the back neck point. Now that I have that drawn, I'm just going to grab a ruler or a straight edge of any type, and I'm going to connect that side back seam. Okay, so the main body is now complete. I forgot to label these points. All right, I'm going to finish drawing the collar, and then that's it for the back pattern. Remember that seam allowances are included in these proportions. So each of these verticals has a seam allowance that is approximately half of the chest dedo. So if I look at this here, this is half a chest dedo. So here's where the seam allowance is. You can see that it's just shy of half an inch. So just know that those allowances are included in every proportion along here. And if it's not, I'm usually very, very clear about the fact that it's not. Right, so now I've drawn that line. Finishing the collar. Let me grab the length tape. I need to measure up from CD right here to LDI. Just right there. And that gives the top of the side of the collar. Now I'm going to gently curve this down so that it blends in. And I'm trying to keep this one smooth, though complex, curve all the way in. There shouldn't really be much in the way of hard angles. This is the tightest angle that you'll get in this shoulder, but it should not be hard point or a hard point, if that makes sense. It needs to be a smooth line. Now this is done. The last thing that I want to do with this pattern is I'm going to measure this edge from CQ to WSI. And I'm going to measure that with the length tape, and I'm just going to notate it right here. We'll need that measurement in order to draft the front properly. So here's my length tape, placing the zero at CQ, and then measuring along the line, I have IT. So if I scoot this to here, so it's, yeah, IT, exactly. So I'm going to mark that L for length, IT. Complete. Now we'll begin drafting the front. We start exactly the same way. The principle of the drafting system doesn't change. So you start by doing the foundation line. Now with the front, I do mark the top because there's nothing that extends above the top of the draft. So This is the top line, so that means that this would be A right here. From here, I'll grab my chest tape and I'll start marking off the points along the foundation line just to the bottom of the armhole. And then I'll draft the top of the garment atop of the front. And then I will grab that measurement off of the back pattern piece, and then I'll find the length that needs to happen here along the side back seam. And then I will find the center of waist and measure outward from the center of waist to front and back. Now, my draft will probably look a lot like the one that's in the book. Your drafts may look different, and I will give you an example of how it looks different. From A, I'm going to work my way down this front of the draft. Let me grab the chest tape. The reason all of these measurements are done with the chest tape and not the length tape is because your chest size, your physical body size, is completely what regulates the size of the shoulder, because the bigger you are, the more tissue that you have, the larger that your neck is, and consequently, the skinnier that you are, the smaller those places are. They're all very interconnected, so we can't use the length tape here because your height doesn't change, but your size does. So, my first mark is CIII. I'm going to mark that right here. The next mark is CD1/2. I'll mark that here. The next mark is CSII. I'll mark that there. And below that is CQ. I'm going to go ahead and draw lines out from all of these except for CD1/2, because that's the bottom of the front neckline and I don't need to draw a line there. Here we go. This one's going to be nice and long because the front is pretty wide. Okay, so now I have all my guidelines. From here, I'll begin to mark my horizontal points. So the depth of the collar is the same as the width of the collar. CD1/2. So I'm moving this up half a dedo and I'm making a mark there. And I usually immediately draw my quarter circle for the front neck, because the next one is the shoulder, and I need to have this point very clear in my mind in order to draw the length of the shoulder. So once again, we're going to measure S. I'm gonna put this here. The zero end goes here at CD1/2. And then I measure S downward to the shoulder slope line. And I'll draw it with the ruler. The next thing is the width of the front, which is SII at SII. So it's the same distance wide as it is down. So that's halfway between S and Q, which is right here. I even made like a little mark on my tape. All right. And then along Q, I have a couple of points to make. It looks like I missed one. I should also have CIQ in here because that's the top of the back. So sorry. Okay. All right, so I have SII, which gives me the frontmost point of the armhole. And now I have CIQ, which regulates the top of the side back. So I'm gonna measure all the way out here, 3/8, which is also TII. I put this notation everywhere in the book because I really want people to understand that the notations can be interchangeable. TII is also 3/8. There's only one manual that actually uses 3/8 when it comes to the extant Spanish manuals, but it's important that you know that it's the same as TII. Once along here, I'm actually going to measure backwards along this half a chest dedo. so that I have seam allowance width right there. The next thing is the bottommost part of the armhole. That would be CQI. So I'm going to here CQ, and I'm just going to make a little pencil mark there so that I can see it, and then I'm going to move one more dado over. So now I have the top of the armhole at the shoulder, frontmost point of the armhole, bottommost point of the armhole, and the rearmost point of the armhole. Now I can connect the dots. So from here, I always start with, I always start here because I need to make a 90 degree angle. And I keep this as straight and flat as possible while gently curving it. And as I hit this frontmost part of the armhole, the curve gets very tight so that I can come into the bottom of the armhole. And then I keep turning the paper. And then this stays quite flat going into the back of the armhole. And what that does is it, if it was a full curved armhole, this would actually be much deeper, like this. This little bit of extra fabric provides a surprising amount of freedom of movement. That's why it's there. This can also be done using an armhole curve. This is my armhole curve. And so all I do is line it up so that the frontmost point and the bottommost point are in relative alignment. I'll draw the line there, it's nice and clean. And then I reverse the ruler and wiggle it into place so that I'm connecting with this line through that point and then up into that point. You can see it's really close to the one that I drew by hand. I always draw my armholes by eye, almost never use this ruler because I've done it so many times, it just becomes second nature. So, now that I have these points figured out, I have to figure out how to place the level of the waist. Now, the way that I've described this in the book is you just make an extra mark along here that equals the depth that you measured off of the back, and that gets you really close. I like to do things a little bit more accurately, which interestingly uses an even more archaic technique of casting an arc. So I'll just assume that it's pretty easy for you to say that back measurement was L-IT. So I can measure from here, which is the top of the side back seam, and I can go L-IT, and there's my waist level here. Now I drew that line really lightly. The other option I have is to treat this like a compass. So it's IT, so I'm just gonna go ahead and subtract the I from this end, and I'm going to place the point of my pencil right there on that mark, and then I'm gonna hold T right here on its mark at the top, and then I'm just going to swing an arc like this. And that means that from any angle along this curve, the measurement is exactly the same. So if I have a large waist, then I'll be hitting this slightly lower. If I have a very narrow waist, then I'll be hitting it slightly higher in here because this angle will come in. Or it'll go straight down, or it will angle out. Next thing I need to do is find the center point for the waist. That's done with the chest tape. Now, every pattern has notated what that measurement is because it changes from pattern to pattern depending on the base form of the pattern. So CSI is the waist centering point. So that uses the chest tape, S plus I puts that waist centering point right here. Now I will need my waist tape because then we measure half the front waist measurement to either side of that point. My waist is 37. I'm measuring SI to the front and SI to the back. So there's S eye, and I'm just doing this with my eyeball. You can do the same, or you can be extra crazy, or extra crazy. You can be extra specific about it. So SI measures to here. So you can see that if I was very narrow-waisted, it would come up along here, and if I was wider, it would drop more toward the back. There's my center, it's the bottom of side back and front. So this could be either a straight line or slightly curved. I tend to, when I'm drawing by hand, I tend to do it slightly curved. If you're padding a garment, making this more curved is better. If you want this to look very slim fitting, a straight line is fine. And I prefer a slimmer look, so I'm going for a straight line. And then from center front, all you do is draw a smooth curved line running into the chest line right here. The next trick is to find the bottom of the point, because the point drops in front. That's done with the chest tape. And you'll notice that we're doing this regulation is happening a portion of the chest, a portion of the length, and another portion of the chest. And that is so that we don't end up with fronts that are too short. It's very common if you regulate everything by the length, you're not taking into account the depth of the chest, right? A person who is larger has a much greater distance between the side of the neck and the apex of the chest. A slimmer person, this is a shorter distance. So if you don't account for all of that up here and you just try to make a standardized length, then larger people will end up with shorter garments that don't look right. So in order to compensate for that and keep the proportion correct, we've regulated everything through the chest here, everything from the back, which is regulated by the length, here, and the remainder by the chest or whatever your taste is for the depth of the point in front. I prefer just using the chest tape. We'll go 3 dedo for the chest tape, and that'll give us the placement of the point. And that is, I just continue this line straight through the point at the front. And then from here, I'm going to try to keep 90 degree angles off of this line and back. And I'm going to try to keep this point actually fairly close to 90 degree angles as well. It could be a little pointier. It doesn't matter that much. But the Bergen style doublet tends to read as a very straight across in front. So if this is a 90 degree angle, it will tend to read as a straight line. If, however, it is an acute angle with more of a point like this, then you'll tend to see a later, like a 1620 style point start to appear. I prefer it to be pretty straight across, almost Germanic looking, because that's the style that Bergen was really going for in his manual. So there's your front. It's done. It's ready to go. What I'm going to do next is cut out the back and the front, and then we'll put them together so that you can see how they relate to each other. Here are my pattern pieces cut out. Now, this is a moment where I do a technique called truing. And that just means looking at edges which go together and making sure that they blend well. I'm not so worried about the armhole. This looks correct to me. But what I am concerned about is these two cut edges should be exactly the same length. So I'm going to match up the top here. I'm going to match up the bottom here. And I'm just going to shorten my front pattern piece ever so slightly to account for that. What that means is while my cut edges are the same length, when I try to sew them together, the front will actually be slightly short. So by making those cut edges correct and matched, that means that when I stitch them up, if I line these up according to where the seam allowance is going to be, I am actually a bit short. I'm almost half an inch too short right here, and that's good, because what that means is that this piece then gets stretched, the front gets stretched this way, and the back will actually get eased down slightly. So this will come like this, and if you see as I'm doing this little pinch, look what happens. You get this little bubble right where the shoulder blade is supposed to go. And when I stretch this way, I'm going to do this by just giving a little slash into it. But when I stretch this way, look what happens here. As I spread that open, what happens is this comes up and this curves according to the shape of the human body. We're putting our seam where the muscle is on the side back, but our body actually has a curve at the side depending on our proportions. So by spreading it here, I'm allowing this to pop up so that it actually follows the contour of the body. It's pretty amazing how this kind of stuff works. Same thing goes for the shoulder. The shoulder is the same length, and yet when I sew them together, the front will actually end up being a little bit short. So I have to stretch the front and I have to shrink the back to make them match each other. I'm going to set the body aside now and we will draft the front collars. Now, Bergen's front collar has two pieces. And most of the other pattern manuals, Bergen's manual has two pieces for the front collar. Both Fraley and Alsega's manuals, the 16th century manuals, they both have single piece front collars. Andujar, on the other hand, who's the manual from 1640, the manual after this one, has both. It has solid front collars as well as two-piece front collars. So all I'll do is I'll draw a foundation line first, like always, and then I'll draw a right angle at one end. That's the beginning. And usually I will put the side of the collar here and the front of the collar on the left. The first thing I need is my length tape, so that we can draft the height of the collar. And we'll make this 1/8, so that's O. And then I like to make a mark, here's O. I usually make a mark halfway between 0 and O, which is at III, and that gives me a place where I can curve in. And this isn't much. It should probably not be more than 1/4 inch curvature. Or 6 millimeters. It's just gentle. All it is to give a gentle trumpeting shape to the collar itself. So my use of the length tape is done. I can set that aside, and now I'm going to move on to using the chest tape. I need to make a mark that is one chest dedo down from A. Let's see if this is A, this is LO. This is LIII, this is CI, here's A. So I have CI right here, and that's going to be the depth of the front of the collar. And I make this regulated by the chest tape because as people get larger, the chin gets a little bit deeper. So if we're accounting for that by using the chest tape, that means the front of the collar won't be hitting the chin of the wearer. So I've got here, and now I need to measure all of my horizontals. So I'm going to draw a line off of my CI, and I am also going to draw a line across with the LII so that I know where the sort of center of the collar height is and I can draw my remaining curves. To get to the frontmost point of the collar, from here I will mark SII along the CI line, and then at the bottom, I will mark one dedo less than that. So this is SI, which I can find right there. Okay. So that gives us a nice trumpet shape to the front of the collar right there. Now I'm going to find my seam placement in the middle. So the back will be CD, and the front is CDI. And that gives us this point where I can just draw a vertical line now and I can see the dividing placement. And if you want to, You can use your length tape to make sure that you've got this exact. I tend to just eyeball everything because that's how I get down. And then here I'm going to make a little mark, not quite a quarter of an inch slash 6 millimeters. And I'm going to curve. It's much easier to draw a curve from the inside of the curve. You can see that. It just works with the body's natural tendency to be a compass. I'm going to curve the bottom the same amount. And then I'll draw the tops. And there we go. Typically what I do is I will make a mark right here as a marking notch. I'll actually like clip this into the pieces once I cut them so that I know that it's this side is down and that I've matched the correct collar pieces to each other. That's the collar draft. We'll move on to the skirts next. Okay, we are moving on to drafting the skirts. Now we'll start with the back skirt and then we'll move on to drafting the front skirt. The techniques are similar, but instead of A being at one end, with these, it's a little bit different because A is in the middle and it's a sort of a spreading point. So we'll begin by drafting the back skirt. I'm gonna do the back skirt over in this little corner here. I'll draw a foundation line. And then following my diagram, I'll just draw a little vertical line up from more or less the center of that place. And then I'll start using my length tape and my waist tape. Those are the only two that I need for this pattern piece. So the center of the skirt, here's A. The center goes up one dedal from A. So I'll mark my one dedal right there. And that gives me the kind of percentage of curvature. Then I'll take my waist tape and to either side, I'll measure D and a half. So we have D and a half there. And then we have D and a half here. Now remember, this is half of the back skirt. This is not the whole back skirt. But it's symmetrical, so we can draft off of the center. So now this total curvature should measure just slightly more than SI, which is the measurement of the back pattern piece. Now if I lay this in place here, I have exactly SI is the length of this. So I know that that matches precisely the back. The next thing I'll do is set the waist tape aside and use the length tape to regulate the depth of the skirt. So that's going to be, in this case, I'm making them pretty narrow. I'm using D. So there's that. And what I'll do to make sure that I get this right is I'll take a ruler and I'll measure a 90 degree angle off of this point right here. Same thing over here. Okay, so that it's 90 degrees. And keep that 90 degrees like right at the very corner. If you measure too far in for your 90 degrees, you'll end up actually with an acute point accidentally. And from all of these points, measure D with the length tape so that the whole skirt is consistently 1/12 wide. So this is LD, LD, LD. All right, and this is WI, WD half, WD half. Okay, and again, I'm trying to keep 90 degree angles as I draw these curves. And my obsession with the 90 degree angles has everything to do with the fact that as it sews to the adjacent skirt piece, this will end up being one smooth edge. If this is an acute angle, then you'll kind of end up with a point here at your join, which you don't want. Best to account for it now while we're in the process of drafting. All right, I'm going to call this center back, and I'm going to call this side back. You can label them if you want to. I usually don't, I just pick one, but for the sake of clarity, just go ahead and mark that up. The next thing I'll do, I won't even cut this out yet, I'm just going to shift over and start drafting the front skirt. So I'll make a very long line along here. I'll make a long line here. And then again, I only need the waist tape, and the length tape for this. The length tape I don't need just yet. I'll start with the waist tape. So here I have, I'm going to put this A is right here, just to the left of center. And then I'm using WI half as the height here. And then I'm measuring down from WI half, WD down here, and then WQI for the front. WQI, right? So this is WD and this is WQI. And now I have the opportunity to do this curve. Now this curve is a little tighter as it goes from D to A. And then just gentle, slightly flatter as it goes from WI half to Q. Same idea here. I'm going to make this 90 degrees right at the corner. This one's a little bit different. This one I'm going to use an obtuse angle, and I can style it however I see fit. There's really not a lot of magic to it. I'm also going to draw a line at right angles to this point so that I can use the length tape to say this is D, and then I'll just mark D all along this curve at various points so that then I can just go through at the end and connect the dots. And what ends up happening here is as I approach this, then I just kind of just go straight right into the center front. If you like a skirt with more flare, you can increase this distance here. So we have WI half as that distance now, but watch what happens. I'll just go ahead and draw right on here. I'll go up to WII, and then I'll measure down to D, and then I'll measure down to QI, which moves this in just a little bit. So the measurement now stays the same, but your percentage of arc is increased. So now 90 degrees takes us to here off of this point. So you can see, and then this comes out another half dedo. So the whole thing gets more and more curved. This is a stylistic approach too, because this has everything to do with how full your breeches are. If you have big breeches with a big roll underneath that have a very wide hip, more flare is better. So you'll want to increase this line here. Anyway, just a little bit of a tidbit for you. This is still LD, LD, LD. Here we have our two skirt pieces cut out, and when I put them together, you can see, see I marked that center back. Let me flip this around. This is how we'll actually go together. You can see the tightness of this curvature. And I used the tighter curvature for the front skirt. And the reason for that is that when I wear these clothes, I really like to have a big hip roll. So I like to pad my breeches out really far, which is a much more period silhouette. most of the people who are using this book should go with the pattern, the way that it's written. And that's everything to do with the fact that the majority of men wearing early 17th century clothing don't feel comfortable padding their hips out incredibly. They feel very awkward in it. Even though it's the correct silhouette, they don't want to do it. So I decided to go with, I thought, what was going to be less problematic over the long term in the book. This is, however, the way that I like to make them, so that there's a good significant flare for a nice poofy pair of pants. The last step in drafting this pattern is to make the doublet sleeve. Now, there's a lot of variation in these sleeves. I'm going with the sleeve that Bergen presents in his manual because it's how he has it in his manual. I think in the grand scheme of things, this sleeve is probably a bit wide for what was actually worn. Most of the paintings and extant garments from the time period definitely show a sleeve that is not quite as round. Process begins exactly the same as the previous pieces. I'm drawing this line all the way down the entire page, even though I probably don't need it. I will go ahead and draw a right angle line at the top so that I have my perpendicular cross lines. And we will begin with the length tape. So I have full understanding of what the length needs to be. So the full length is L triple Q. Okay, that's the entire length. And that goes to the outside of the wrist, which is the lowest point of the arm, lowest point of the sleeve. And that goes to the outside of the wrist, which is the lowest part of the sleeve. I also want to mark the elbow, which I systematically do at 3/8, so that's TII with the length. And then from those points, I will draw my lines. I'm going to make a mark with the length tape that is two dedos above the L triple Q, and that is L T T I I. And this is actually the frontmost part of the sleeve. I need to use the length tape one more time to be able to set the depth of the curvature of the sleeve. And again, this is one of those curvatures where it's similar to the center back neck, in that I'm using the length tape because if I use the chest tape, there's the possibility that it could go way too far. The length tape makes a lot more sense because it will stay more consistent across a majority of sizes. So this is two dedos that it's deviated in from here. So I have the front of the wrist and the crook of the elbow. Now all I need to be able to draw the front seam of the sleeve is where is the front of the sleeve cap. So for that, I'll switch to using the chest tape and I'll make some marks. I will have C triple I. So III, which is right here. And then I'm going to add 1/2 of a dedo to that for CIII and a half. And all that is that just gives us the bottommost part of the armhole. So I'm going to draw a line out from the triple I and a half right there. And then the diagram in the book shows that the bottommost part of the armhole is C-IS. So that's one less than S. And in this instance, it's easy for me to put S right here and just make my mark one dedo away from the end of the tape. So I'm making my first mark at I, and that gives us the bottom of the armhole. So that's C-IS. And then I want the top of the cap, so I'm going to mark CS right here. And then the full width of the cap of the sleeve is CT. So then we draw this out to T. And that's the full width. And you have two choices. You can use a narrow seam allowance and have a little bit of gathering at the cap of the sleeve, or you can use a much wider seam allowance and have this fit in smoothly. But to complete the sleeve draft, we should move on. We measure this out to T. Then we need to find the elbow, which we measure at T plus I. So that bumps this out to here. We can extend this line if we need to so that we have some really clean guidance. And then we'll find the width of the wrist, which is CO. So 1/8 down here. So that 1/8 connects to LTTII. And then this becomes a nice smooth curve that goes all the way to CIII for the front of the sleeve. Now you can do this with rulers if you'd like. All right, so now we have the foreseam, we have the wrist. The next thing is this curvature here just blends right up into that, and then it'll just go straight all the way to the back. And then we'll use the chest tape and we'll mark half a dedo along this curve up from this point, and we'll mark half a dedo in from the back of the sleeve cap over here. And that gives us we have our sleeve cap curve. Next, we take the tape, we measure one full dedo in from C triple I, and we'll measure one full dedo in from C T at the back. Those marks then can be blended into the CIS mark at the armpit. And now we have the bottommost part of the cap. So you'll notice we're drafting the sleeve with both the outer and inner portions of the sleeve on top of each other. I have two layers of paper here, so what I'll end up doing is I'll draw the whole sleeve, both layers here, and then I will cut out both layers of paper around the large sleeve, around the outer sleeve, and then I will set that aside, and then I'll just cut away this on this pattern piece so that I have an outer and inner sleeve pattern. I know that they match because they've been drafted together. So the next thing we do is we have to draw the hind seam. Now this sleeve is crazy bulbous. So you can see that I'm kind of sketching in a line until I see a shape that matches what the diagram is, and then I'll formalize the line. The next thing that I need to do, though, is draw in my seam allowance. So I have a full dedo seam allowance at the cap, which tapers to a narrower seam allowance at the wrist. So it's about half a chest dedo at the bottom, and then a full chest dedo at the top. And the reason for that is you are much more likely to have to change fitting in the body of the garment than you are at the wrist of the garment. So you leave a wider allowance up here and you taper on the way down. That way, if you let the body out tremendously, you've got allowance in the sleeve to work with. And that's the sleeve pattern. My next step then I'll just set my excess paper aside. Before I separate this into inner and outer sleeve halves, I'm going to mark my wrist opening. And that means this vent, this is where the buttons and buttonholes will go, can be marked so that I know where it is. And that typically I have both layers of paper together. So then I will fold them on that little mark and I'll just clip a little corner right off so that I have a notch that I can work with. Now that I've got that, I need to do the same thing for the top of the sleeve, which will match up to the shoulder seam. So I'm going to give that a little fold right there, just at that mark. I'm going to clip a little corner off so that I have a little V-shaped notch. Now I have my outsleeve pattern ready to go. Then I just remove the cap, leaving my undersleeve. And I'm going to do the same thing with this armpit notch. I'm going to fold right there on that piece of paper, or on that mark. And then I'm going to clip the corner away, which gives me a little V-shaped notch. Now your pattern is ready for layout.